In the early 2000s, entire rivers in Washington vanished, groundwater shriveled away, and salmon, once the lifeblood of these valleys, went extinct. Engineers poured millions into concrete dams and pipelines, but nothing reversed the drought, and wildfires only grew more savage. Then came an idea that sounded absurd: release beavers onto land so dead even trees wouldn't grow. What followed wasn't just river revival, but it was a transformation no one believed possible, with wildfires dropping by 40% and salmon flooding back in numbers nobody thought they'd see again. But how did these rodents pull off what high-tech engineering could not? The answer starts with the ruins of an ecosystem on the brink. On the valley floors of Washington's Methow and Yakima basins, silence replaced the sound of running water. Where salmon once surged upstream every spring, only dry gravel and bone-white cobbles remained. The rivers that shaped these valleys for thousands of years now broke apart into shrinking pools, then nothing at all. By the mid-2000s, entire stretches of the Methow ran dry for weeks at a time. Groundwater, once held in deep reserves beneath willow and cottonwood, dropped so far that even mature trees withered and died. The air grew hotter each summer, the land more brittle, and wildfires tore through what little was left, sometimes burning 70% or more of the remaining riparian forests in a single season. Chinook salmon, the lifeblood of these watersheds, collapsed to record lows. Natural runs teetered on the edge of extinction, with wild fish nearly gone and only hatchery-raised survivors keeping the species from vanishing completely. The state's own records counted fewer and fewer wild spawners each year until entire tributaries registered zero returns. For the Yakima and Methow, the loss wasn't just about fish. It was about the unraveling of an entire ecosystem. Eagles, bears, and otters lost their food source. Streams that once ran cool and deep turned into stagnant trickles, choked with algae and silt. With the rivers gone, the land itself began to change. Topsoil blew away in dust storms. Without the shade of streamside trees, summer temperatures soared and evaporation stripped what little water remained. Rain, when it finally came, couldn't soak in. Instead, it rushed over the hardened ground, carving new gullies and carrying away the last remnants of life. Mudslides swept through empty channels, scouring what had already been abandoned by fish and forest. On satellite images, the transformation was stark. Lush green corridors faded to brown scars stretching for miles. Ponds and wetlands shrank or vanished, replaced by cracked earth and invasive weeds. In some places, even the most resilient plants, willow, aspen, sedge, gave up. What remained was a landscape that looked more like desert than the Pacific Northwest. For local communities, the crisis was personal. Farmers watched irrigation wells run dry. Ranchers lost grazing land to dust and fire. Tribal elders recalled stories of salmon runs so thick you could walk across their backs, now reduced to memories. Every year, the question grew sharper. If the rivers could die here, what hope was left for the land? The need for a new solution was no longer just urgent. It was absolute. Concrete and steel were the first answers. Engineers drew up plans for massive water storage reservoirs, hoping to trap the last trickles of snowmelt before they could vanish into the thirsty ground. Construction bids ran into the millions. Building just a single reservoir could cost anywhere from $500,000 to $2 million, not including the price of land, legal fees, or the endless maintenance that followed. In the Yakima and Methow valleys, agencies poured money into diversion canals and lined stream beds with concrete. The goal was to force water to stay where it was needed most. But these projects came with a hidden price. Straightened channels moved water faster, not slower. In winter, they triggered flash floods that tore away topsoil and left fields buried in debris. By summer, the same rivers dried up weeks earlier than before, the water having slipped away long before crops needed it. As the crisis deepened, some districts tried to go bigger. Multi-million dollar pipeline projects promised to move water from distant rivers, but each new proposal ran into a wall of lawsuits and environmental reviews. Farmers and city planners argued over whose rights would come first. Even when construction began, delays and cost overruns piled up. One high-profile diversion scheme in Idaho, planned to stabilize flows in the Boise Basin, saw real-time monitoring and channel realignment rolled out in 2017. Despite automation and new data, river flows kept dropping, up to 300 cubic feet per second lost at Caldwell, with urbanization and irrigation changes outpacing any engineering fix. The water simply would not stay put. A 2017 study from the University of Idaho laid out the hard truth. Traditional engineering, no matter how advanced, could not keep up with the scale of the problem. Channelized rivers and hard infrastructure failed to restore flows or bring back lost wetlands. In some cases, the fixes even made things worse, exposing more land to erosion, cutting off groundwater recharge, and leaving the river less resilient to drought than before. Resource managers found themselves trapped in a cycle of spending and disappointment. Each year brought new emergency repairs, more money spent, and less water to show for it. The frustration grew. Clearly, no man-made structure could replace what once happened here naturally. The land was still dying. The question was no longer how much concrete to pour, but whether a different kind of solution was even possible. In the wake of failed engineering, a new idea began to take root, one that sounded almost too simple. What if the answer wasn't more concrete, but more teeth and tails? Joe Wheaton, a fisheries biologist raised on the Pacific coast, had spent years watching expensive restoration projects wash out in the first big flood. Meanwhile, in the rare places where beavers had survived, rivers ran cooler and deeper even through drought. Wheaton's field notes told a plain story. Wherever beavers persisted, water stayed. Where they were gone, the land dried out. He wasn't alone. Colleagues like hydrologist G. Matthias Condolf and ecologist Dr. Michael Pollock were reaching the same conclusion. Nature's own engineers had been doing the work far longer and far better than any blueprint could promise. By the early 2000s, Washington's policy had already started to shift. The state banned body-gripping beaver traps in 2000, and as fur prices collapsed, the old trapping culture faded. This gave beaver populations a chance to recover, but not always in the right places. Some ended up flooding roads or orchards, sparking complaints from landowners. But for Wheaton and a growing group of scientists, these so-called nuisance beavers were an opportunity. Instead of removing them for good, what if they could be moved to the places that needed them most? Streams stripped bare by drought and fire. The Methow Beaver Project launched in 2008 as a partnership between the US Forest Service, the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife, and the Methow Salmon Recovery Foundation. Tribal leaders from the Confederated Tribes of the Colville Reservation joined as well, bringing a perspective rooted in thousands of years of coexistence. In Colville tradition, beaver is seen as the engineer who made salmon possible. Their elders remembered a time when beaver ponds laced every valley, holding back water and life itself. Now, science and story pointed to the same solution. The project's first years were part experiment, part leap of faith. Captured beavers from lowland farms were given health checks, tagged, and released into headwater streams once written off as lost. Each release was a small act of hope, sometimes marked by sage smoke ceremonies, sometimes by quiet anticipation. Early results surprised even the skeptics. Within a season, the first relocated beavers built small dams, and wet patches began to spread on ground that had been bone dry for years. Monitoring teams recorded the return of willow shoots, dragonflies, and even the first trickle of cool water late into summer. Biodiversity counts ticked upward. For the first time in decades, it felt like the land was breathing again. By 2009, the Methow Beaver Project had become a model for others. The cost was a fraction of any engineered fix, just a few thousand dollars per beaver pair, including transport and follow-up. More importantly, the project offered something money couldn't buy, a chance to let nature repair itself. The idea was no longer just a theory. It was an initiative, rooted in both science and tradition, ready to be tested on the deadest land in the state. Trapping a beaver is nothing like trapping a raccoon or a rabbit. Each relocation starts with a call, usually from a frustrated landowner whose orchard or irrigation ditch has become a beaver's latest project. Wildlife technicians move in with live traps baited with apple slices and willow branches. Sometimes it takes days for a beaver to venture in. Once caught, the animal is transferred to a holding tank for a full health check. Not every beaver makes the cut. Only healthy, compatible pairs are selected, each one weighed, measured, and fitted with a tiny GPS tag tucked beneath the fur. It's a process designed to give these animals the best shot at survival in a place they've never seen. Some destinations are so remote that trucks and ATVs can't get close. In 2018, a helicopter airlifted beaver pairs into the upper reaches of the Methow watershed, crated and dangling beneath the rotors. One trip nearly ended in disaster when a cable snagged on a pine branch mid-flight. The pilot steadied the load, ground crews held their breath, and the beavers touched down unharmed, earning cheers from the scientists and tribal youth waiting below. The cost for all this? about $2,000 to $3,000 per beaver pair. That covers trapping, health screening, transport, and monitoring. For comparison, building a single small reservoir can run over $500,000. Yet every relocation is a gamble. Some beavers take off downstream and vanish. Others settle in, begin chewing willow, and start the slow work of dam construction. Each release is watched closely, sometimes by biologists with clipboards, sometimes by tribal elders and youth who gather to welcome the animals back. Sage smoke drifts over the water, a blessing for the journey ahead. In Colville tradition, the beaver is more than an animal. It's a first citizen, an engineer who brings back water and stories alike. Not everyone is convinced. At town hall meetings and county hearings, farmers voice concerns about flooded fields and chewed fence posts. Some remember past seasons when beaver dams sent water into hayfields at the wrong moment. The project team promises rapid response. If a relocated beaver causes trouble, a hotline stands ready and the animal can be moved again. Over time, even the skeptics begin to notice a change. Where beavers stay, late summer water lingers in the creek. Fire lines hold, willows and cottonwoods sprout where dust once blew. By 2021, more than 400 beavers had been moved to new homes across the Methow and Yakima, Yak-Uma, basins. Each one is a wager on the land's ability to heal itself, if only given the right engineers and a little patience. In the years after beavers returned to the Methow and Yakima valleys, water began to move in ways that hadn't been seen for decades. Hydrologists installed dozens of monitoring wells and stream gauges across the new beaver sites. The data told a story even skeptics couldn't ignore. In places where beaver ponds spread out across the floodplain, groundwater levels rose by 0.5 meter or more. Some sites measured over 13 million liters of groundwater recharge each year, enough to keep wells flowing late into August when nearby fields ran dry. But the impact didn't stop at water. In July 2014, the Carlton Complex fire swept through Okanogan County, burning more than 250,000 acres. Satellite and drone images captured a single unmistakable pattern: ribbons of green, living wetland winding through scorched earth. Wherever beaver ponds had matured, fire slowed or stopped. Firefighters on the ground watched as flames hit the edge of these wet corridors and fizzled out, leaving thick willow and sedge untouched. Post-fire surveys found that beaver-restored floodplains experienced 40% less fire severity compared to similar areas without ponds. For the first time in years, perennial flows returned to creeks that had once disappeared by midsummer. Wetlands expanded, and the landscape itself seemed to resist drought and disaster. These weren't just small patches of recovery. They were proof that a handful of rodents could out-engineer millions of dollars worth of concrete and steel. The evidence was now impossible to ignore. Beavers were changing the fate of the land, one dam at a time. Juvenile salmon counts in the Methow and Yakima basins soared within a few years of beaver reintroduction. Monitoring teams recorded up to 5 times more young salmon in streams where beaver dams had reshaped the channels compared to reaches where the water still ran bare and fast. Fry found shelter in the cool, slow pools behind the dams, habitat that had been missing for decades. As the fish returned, so did the birds, amphibians, and mammals that depend on salmon runs for food. The transformation was so dramatic that regional agencies began to document the results in policy manuals. In 2024, King County published a new restoration guide, urging all river projects to plan for beavers as central partners, not pests. Their advice: overplant willow and cottonwood, expect beaver appetite, and design every fish passage with these builders in mind. The economic impact caught the attention of budget committees and conservation groups alike. State reviews showed every dollar spent on beaver relocation brought back between $8 and $23 in avoided costs. Less money spent on firefighting, flood repairs, and artificial water storage. The numbers convinced skeptics from both sides of the aisle. Instead of fighting nature, agencies across Washington redirected millions toward process-based restoration, using beavers and their analogs as the foundation. Word spread far beyond the Pacific Northwest. By 2023, new beaver-driven restoration projects launched in Oregon, Idaho, and California. Even European countries, facing their own droughts and salmon declines, began to import lessons from Washington's experiment. Conservation teams from Scotland to Germany now use beaver rewilding as a tested model, betting that what worked on dead land in America could revive rivers around the globe. Within a decade of reintroducing over 400 beavers to Washington's drought-ravaged watersheds, groundwater recharge reached 13 million liters, and the severity of wildfires dropped by 40%, according to state well records and fire maps. Salmon, once declared extinct in the Methow and Yakima basins, returned at up to 5 times their previous numbers, documented by annual fish surveys. These results follow decades of failed concrete infrastructure projects, some costing over $30 million, that could not restore river flows or habitat. Yet, questions remain. Not all streams respond equally, and long-term impacts on downstream water rights are still under study. Today, King County's 2024 Restoration Manual and new European projects cite these outcomes as evidence that nature-based solutions can outperform traditional engineering. The transformation of dead land in Washington is now a documented case of ecological recovery, measured in water, fish, and fire resilience, not just hope.